Drawback entries may be signed by any of the following persons except vice president. So we saw that corporate officer. So that's by default. The owner of a sole proprietorship, yes. So we're looking for exception, right? A licensed customs broker with a power of attorney. So here it was without, but here we already have a power of attorney. So this one C is good. An unlicensed drawback consultant. So what did we talk about before when we talked about customs business, right? Drawback, engaging in drawback, or even drawback related activities, what does it constitute? It constitutes customs business within the meaning of 111.2, right? I'm sorry, 111.1, which defines customs business to include drawback and related activities that relate to the preparation of drawback. And if it's customs business, you have to have a license. You have to have a customs broker license. You have to have a permit. For the drawback, we have an exception. You don't have to have that particular permit, but generally speaking, you do. And you have to have a power of attorney. So, unlicensed drawback consultant, if they engage in drawback-related preparation activities or drawback filing, they engage in customs business. So, is that going to be a problem? Yes, it's going to be a problem because they need a license to conduct customs business. So, D is an exception. Any employee of the business entity with a power of attorney, so as we mentioned before, 140-146, power of attorney is required. Without it, you have no authority to do so on behalf of someone else, unless you're doing it for yourself. So, power of attorney is a must. Okay, so here D is the correct answer because it is an exception. All right, so drawback compliance program. So why would you want to go through drawback compliance program? Because you get reduced penalties. And what are these penalties that we're talking about? Well, it turns out that we discussed this in some length in fine penalties and forfeitures, but we kind of avoided that drawback appendix. So 171 is a part that deals with fines, penalties, and forfeitures. And at the end, we have an appendix, heavily tested appendix 1592, appendix B. 1497 is the one that deals with a mischievous licensed customs broker who did some violations under the color of their license. I'm sorry, that's 1641. The 1593A is a special carve-out statute that deals with drawback violations. So when something goes wrong, customs officer, fines, penalties, forfeitures officer, has to look at this particular appendix. They may also have some internal guidance document, but they have to look at that appendix because this will determine how much you have to pay as opposed to whether you have to pay at all. So it deals with fraud, negligence in furtherance of a drawback claim. So you stated that customs has to give you back X amount of dollars, while it was much, in fact, it should have been much less. So that's depriving customs of revenue, so customs takes this seriously. So degree of culpability are negligence and fraud. Unlike 1592 violations, where you introduce merchandise through false pretenses, here you don't have that gross negligence problem, right? It's either fraud or negligence, right? So if it's fraud, forget about it. No drawback compliance program for you. If it's negligence, right? And negligence simply means falling below the reasonable care. Reasonable care, I know it's a vague concept. We discussed this to some extent under the broker responsibility section. But essentially what it means is that there is a standard. As a licensed customs broker, you have to follow the law. You have to know the rules. You are presumed to be a sophisticated person with knowledge. So the standard of care is that you follow the rules. If you are the importer or the drawback claimant who is not a licensed customs broker and who is doing it on his own, then your level of reasonable care is expected to be less, especially if you are sole proprietor, if you're a single person, because all parties are expected to follow rules, regulations, and applicable laws. This discretion, right, the reasonable care discretion, gives some kind of flexibility to say, okay, this guy, this is not what he does day in and day out. He doesn't do drawback. Well, if it's a corporate licensed customs broker where there is a drawback department and all they do is file drawback entries, the expectation of level of expertise to those folks will be much higher. So their reasonable care standard is much higher. So that's the negligence, all right? Assessment of penalties. Let's see, maximum penalties for fraud, if you intentionally deceive customs, meaning that you have culpable mental state, right? Amount not to exceed 3 times of actual potential loss of revenue. So 3 times the amount you've been asking. Negligence, however, is 20% of the actual potential loss of revenue for first violation, so you have a sliding scale, right? But if you are participating in that compliance program, and I'm going back to the outline now, then you can get a free pass. You can get a warning. In other words, you can get a slap on the wrist. Like, yeah, you ever been pulled over by the police officer for the speeding, and they let you off with a warning, and you're like so happy, right? So this is kind of like that type of situation, but except to qualify, you have to go get into that compliance program. All right, so who is eligible? The guys who made false statements, but that did not amount to the fraud. So it amounted to the negligence. How do you get qualified, right? Well, you have to be able to demonstrate certain level of preparedness, or at least the certain level of the ability that you can survive that compliance program, if you will. And there is a bullet line, there is a bullet point list. So this laundry list of items, you can see that customs will likely test you on that laundry list of items. So it is helpful to take a note of this. So drawback filer must demonstrate legal requirements for filing claims, knowledge of procedures, individuals who are dependable, they must have some kind of record-keeping program, and reporting procedures to CBP. All right. So again, a classic way for customs examiners to test you on the laundry list is to list you all the ones that qualify and then say, okay, give me the one which is falls in an exception. So, yeah, custom examiners in the past have asked about, with respect to drawback compliance program, the following question. A person may be certified for drawback compliance program. So immediately if you see drawback compliance program buzzwords, you go to that list. So in order to be certified as a participant, the party must be also able to demonstrate all of the following except. So you go through the list and you see what's right, what's wrong. Understanding legal requirements for filing claims is number one on the list. So That's not an exception, so we move on. Having established procedure to explain the customs requirements to those employees involved in preparation of claims. So do we have those procedures? Yes, number two, procedures in place for the explanation of CBP requirements. So B is not an exception. Having a dependable individual who will be responsible for compliance. Is that on the list? Dependable individual is 3 on the list. So this is not an exception, so we move on. D, having a record maintenance program approved by CBP. Is that on the list? Record maintenance program is number 4 on the list. So D is all right. E, having a procedures for notifying the importer for variances or violations of. All right, do we have that on the list? So we have a procedure for notifying customs. Here, they suggest that it should be the importer who is notified. No, you should notify customs, right? Corrective actions, take corrective actions when notified by customs, not when notified by the importer of violations. So importer here is incorrect placement of words. It should be CBP, Customs Bureau Protection, or simply customs, not the importer. Therefore, it fits the exception. It fits the exception because if it was customs here, it would be all right. But since the importer here is stated, it makes this proposition under E incorrect, which fits the exception. Since we're looking for exception, E is the correct answer choice. Okay, so that's it for drawback. It has been a fine journey, much longer than the previous time. It has been some time since I've done a lecture on drawback. Most likely there will be ins and outs throughout as customs adopts regulations to come into the compliance with Trade Enforcement and Trade Facilitation Act. But drawback is a serious topic. Drawback with regular frequency appears on the customs broker license exam. So this time is not a wasted time. Other than the fact that this is interesting and exciting stuff, in my view, I think this is beneficial because it is certainly knowledge of drawback stuff will get you will save you some points on the customs license broker examination. So that completes our journey with respect to drawback.